next. Pennridge School Board welcomes public comment according to policy 903. We remind everyone of the following. Public comment shall be limited to 3 minutes unless otherwise specified by the board. Participants must be recognized by the presiding officer and note their name and municipality. All statements shall be directed to the presiding officer rather than to individual board members, district employees, or members of the public. A speaker may speak once during each comment period. Please note that these sessions are designated for comments. Questions raised and not addressed may be followed up at a later time. Thank you. Any questions from the public? Comments? Thank you, Mrs. Yard. Seeing none, the first we have on the agenda is the Bayada per diem nursing contract. Mrs. McHale, if you want to take over on that.
Thank you, Mr. Ragomo. Before we get into that, I had two quick announcements. One is that we completed our PIMS reporting for highly qualified teachers, and I'm very excited and very pleased to say that Pennridge School District has 100% highly qualified teachers, and we have reported that to the state and our report was accepted. So that's fantastic news. It's been getting a little bit more difficult each year for the school districts to obtain 100% highly qualified status with the stringent special education regulations that have changed in regard to certification. So we are extremely proud of that. Secondly, at your spots, you will see an HR newsletter. This is the first of its kind, and it is dedicated to the open enrollment for 2016. We've filled it with a lot of useful information for the staff, and it has been sent out to all staff members electronically and a hard copy for those that don't have access, so that they could access all the documents they need for open enrollment. So we're also real proud of that, and I want to thank my department for putting that together and going over it with a fine-tooth comb to make sure everything's accurate. All right, first on our list is the Bayada per diem nursing contract, and we are asking the board to consider this agreement to provide per diem substitute nursing in an effort to maintain the safety of our students. It has become increasingly difficult to hire substitute nurses on a per diem basis. So this will help us fill in the gaps where we are unable to hire our own substitute nurses. And the agreement has been reviewed by our solicitor. He made a few tweaks, sent it back, they agreed, and now we are presenting it to the board and hope to have that approved on May 16th. Are there any questions?
I have a question, Mrs. McHale. The first page of the contract, I guess the second paragraph, the last sentence, will provide basic nursing care and teaching services to its students. Why teaching services? They're nurses. And nowhere, truly nowhere in there does it say they're going to provide teaching services, just there.
Right. They're not engaging in any teaching services at all. I can certainly go back to them and question why they have that statement in there. Again, I'm assuming it's a standard contract that they use for school districts, and there may be instances where they do come in and actually teach if they're CSNs. I'm not sure.
No.
Okay.
Well, not in my experience. No, they do not teach. They are strictly, they're strictly to care for the student. But nowhere else in the contract did it mention it, or any kind of certification, or any kind of, you know, professional involvement. So anyway, I was just curious why that was in there. Thank you.
No, I'll look into that and I'll get an answer to you.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. That was in paragraph two?
Oh, yeah, the last sentence.
Okay, yeah, I see it. Are there any other questions regarding the Bayada contract?
Yes. At least in the copy that was sent to us, it was dated April 12th. I presume you're going to update that date.
We will update. That was one of our first drafts, and it's been going back and forth between our solicitor and their legal department. So we will update for the final, okay, for the board meeting on May 16th.
Right. Anyone else?
Okay, second on the list was the updated, revised, I should say, job description for the van driver. And the main reason for the revision is to remove the requirement for a CDL license. And I have Mr. Geiger here tonight, Brian Geiger, our interim transportation director, who might be able to answer a few questions you have regarding that. But basically, it's to attract a larger pool of candidates to drive vans. They will still have the option to obtain a CDL license through the district. Mr. Geiger's a trainer, as well as our assistant interim. But at this time, there is no requirement, state or federal, that requires a van driver to have a CDL license. So we're sort of prohibiting ourselves from obtaining the pool of candidates that the other districts in the area are. So Brian, if you have a few words you can say on that, that would be appreciated.
Yes, I'm very familiar with all the other districts. I'm a member of the Montgomery Bucks Pupil Transportation Association, and I did pool them, and I think that was included in your packet. Those are the only ones that did respond back, but there are quite a number of them that do have van drivers, but none of them require a CDL. What they do require, and is also included in our job description, would be to obtain an annual school bus physical, driver physical. That physical will stay in-house. It does not go to the state, because the state does not keep record of that for van drivers, but they do for the school bus drivers. So we will still require it of our drivers. I feel it's necessary because they are just as responsible for the students as are our CDL drivers, and I want to make sure that they're physically fit to do the job. So that is why we are mandating as a district to require that as part of their job description. Other than that, I mean, we just cleaned it up, requiring a Class C license instead of a CDL. And it, like she said, it does give us a wider pool. Since being here, I've had several calls regarding driving of vans, and I had to turn them down because the agreement, it doesn't actually spell it out as a CDL driver, but the contract does not have a van driver rate in it. Years ago, for some reason, maybe 6, 7, 8 years ago, it was taken out of the contract, leaving it as just drivers are required to have a CDL, so that at that point means everybody. So I just feel that with all the other districts in the area doing the same thing, why are we doing something totally different? Tying our hands on who we can hire and cannot hire. It goes through the same process. They'll get trained on what they need to do with the van, how to operate it and everything, but they just won't required to get an $82.50 license every 4 years, or every 4 years, and go through all the recertification as a school bus driver. Any other questions? Yes, Ada.
One little question.
Sure.
The drug and alcohol testing, who performs that?
We have an outside organization, DSI, that does our testing for us. They handle the pool. We update we update the list to make sure that anyone that no longer works here is taken out before the quarter, and at the end of every quarter, we get a request to update our list. We add new people, we take people off, anything like that that has to happen. After that's completed, the first week of the next quarter, they email us an update, a list for the next quarter, who's going to be selected. And at that time, if we have people we know that are not going to be working, or are on leave of absence, we request an alternate at that time, and they send us a new list. We set the dates, we tell them when we want to do them. I move them around, beginning of the quarter, end of the quarter, beginning of the week, end of the week, middle of the week. I choose the 2 days that they come. We just completed them this week for this quarter, Monday and Tuesday, and it was the first time they said they ever had them done on a Monday, so that was a surprise for my drivers when they got called out on a Monday morning to come in for drug testing.
After the weekend.
Yeah. After the weekend, yeah. So, you know, I like to mix it up. I don't like it to be a routine, the same time every quarter. So I've always done it that way. But we have no control over the list as far as who is selected. We just make sure that all the employees are on the list. Now, the list that these people, van drivers, would be on is a non-DOT test that they would be taking. It's almost the same thing, but just a little bit different of requirements for that one. But yeah, they still would be randomly. People can be picked 4 times a year. So people may not be picked for years. But we always reserve the right on reasonable suspicion to send them automatically on our own if we have any suspicions.
Thank you.
One quick question I had.
Yes.
Who paid for the CDL licensing? Was that, did we pay for them or was that?
We train them. We train them at no cost. But then also, I believe our drivers get a $60 reimbursement when they have to, every time they pay for their full license, I think the district reimburses them $60. So in essence, we pay for a big portion of it. The rest of it would normally be what they would get as a Class C. But yeah, that would save us that money too. We wouldn't be required to pay that out every 4 years for those van drivers.
Thank you.
Sure.
Any other? Third is Mr. Brockman.
Okay, Mr. Brockman has requested a sabbatical leave of absence. His request is for the spring semester of the 16-17 school year and then the fall semester of 17-18 school year. He's requesting an educational or professional development sabbatical. He does meet all the minimal requirements as outlined in the school code, as well as the school district policy 338 under sabbaticals. Mr. Brockman's sabbatical is going to be to pursue a doctoral program in American history. He will be doing a combination of coursework and professional development. The cabinet has reviewed his request. I went back to him with a few tweaks, and he has met all the requirements that we've asked of him. And we believe that the rigor involved is in compliance with the code as well as the sabbatical policy guidelines. So we'll be asking the board for permission to grant his sabbatical on May 16th. Are there any other questions? Any questions on that?
Can you repeat the dates?
He is looking for the second semester, so the spring of 2016-17, that half year, and then he would take the second half, the first semester of 2017-18 school year in the fall. He's going to split the year.
How often can teachers take a sabbatical?
Can you speak up a little bit?
I said, how often can they take a sabbatical?
Okay, so once they've taken a sabbatical, they have to wait 7 years to be eligible again.
And has he taken a sabbatical before?
No, he has not.
Fourth item is regarding the source for teachers.
The fourth item is, my apologies for bringing this in at the last minute, and I'm still waiting for the addendum, which will just basically be a paragraph adding this to the source for teachers contract. We're asking to, as I said in the email, an addendum to compensate several short-term subs that are coming on board in the last few weeks that don't meet the long-term sub requirement to be hired by the district, and provide them with the $25 additional responsibility rate that actually the board approved earlier on in the school year, maybe in August. And some of this is a result of medical emergencies where the teacher had to leave and now we have to replace them. We don't have time to hire them through the district, so we're hiring them through Source for Teachers, but they're doing lesson plans, and they have, you know, added responsibilities, assessment of students, grading, etc., that a per diem substitute wouldn't normally incur. So we are asking the board if you would consider adding that to the Source for Teacher addendum for, I believe we're up to about four or five, Troy, short-term subs now throughout the district that are filling in here and there. Does anybody have any questions on that?
Is that what most other districts do?
I'm not really sure what other districts do in regard to that. I know they give them an extra stipend. I can't say for sure that it's $25. That's what's in our teacher contract, so that's where the number comes from. And if we were hiring them ourselves, if we had time to hire them ourselves, we would provide them with the $25 additional. It's been the practice at Pennridge.
That's in the teacher's contract regarding
subs? Yeah, it's
subs.
An additional, well, not really for subs. It's an additional duty fee for teachers. So that's where that $25 comes from, and that's been a practice for years. When there's, you know, again, the extra duties involved, the extra responsibilities of lesson plans and assessment and so forth.
Isn't there also a change in rate after they're here for a certain number of days?
Right, the change in rate is through Source for Teachers. There's a day 1 through 20 rate of $95, and then it goes to $100 day 21 on. That's for a per diem sub.
But they would get this in the beginning if they had the additional duty, if they were acting as a teacher, right, doing the lesson.
Right,
yeah. From the beginning.
Right.
And then the last will be Mr. Allen regarding a health care update. I'm going to ask
everyone.
Thank you, Mr. Allen, if you'd be so kind. On the microphone, there's a face with the bars, the circles going.
Like to push that,
you'll see the red light will come on.
The red light.
There you go. Perfect. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I am delighted to be here tonight to get a chance to talk to you about the self-funded medical and prescription drug plans and to talk about self-funding. Kind of walk through the difference between self-funding and fully insured for the benefit plan financial arrangement. So what we've done, is kind of a real quick overview of self-funded benefits compared to fully insured benefits. Self-funded funded benefits basically are, a fully insured plan has a fixed premium and a fixed benefit structure to it. So for the most part, it is what it is. The premiums for the plan are leveled during the course of a month, or pardon me, each month during the course of a year. With self-funded plans, it doesn't work out that way. There are some real cost-saving advantages to self-funding, and I'll just start out at the top and say, a self-funded plan, as opposed to being structured in just a bundled package like a fully insured plan is unbundled. So you pay the fixed monthly costs, which would be the administrative fee, and in our case, because you've got stop-loss coverage, stop-loss premium. So those two are fixed each month. The variable in the self-funded plan becomes the claims. So the claims you pay as they're presented for payment. By the administrator. So we have an administrator that we pay the administrative fee to, that makes sense, right? And we have a stop-loss carrier that we pay the stop-loss premium to. But beyond that, then, are the claims. So that's, as I say, that's our variable from month to month. They can be up or down. But there's some significant cost savings if we've designed this thing right and we've managed it right. And because the district had the foresight many, many years ago to get involved in this, you're well ahead of most of the school districts, probably across the country, because you're very mature into your self-funded plan. And we can look back for years, and actually I'll bore you for a little bit with some of the statistics on it, and show you that it's really been a good experience for the school, and was a great decision that was made back years ago. Anyway, one of the really nice benefits to it is that right now we've got the Affordable Care Act that we're all wrestling with, whether it's on an individual basis, a small group basis, or on a large basis like we're talking about here. In a fully insured plan, they're really getting hammered for the taxes in those plans. And I would say to you that you're gonna see some more numbers for me here. 4 to 4.5% is what's being taxed on a fully insured premium. And by the way, that's in addition to a higher set premium than you'd be looking at from the get-go. So it really puts a fully insured plan further and further back in terms of self-funding. Okay, so now we're gonna take a real quick look at fully insured benefits. I've talked about it, but I'll just give you this, that it's a fully insured plan is bundled, meaning that the premiums are fixed. A lot of times it's seen, a fully insured plan is seen as safer and more conservative. And the fact is that if we pull the two together and we compare them, you're gonna realize that the reason that the fully insured plan appears like it's gonna hold up better and can maintain its level premium is because it's charging you a whole lot more to insure the risk than you can do on your own, assuming you're a big enough group to self-fund, okay? And you certainly are that. One of the other problems with fully insured plans is, and this, some of this stuff is by design from the insurance carriers, that it's difficult to get an accurate feel for what your plan actually costs. And any of us who have ever tried to get experience from a fully insured carrier realize that that information is very, very difficult to come by. And you know, as you start to look for real transparency in it, there really isn't any. That's a problem. Because even if you're a fully insured plan and you want to move to self-funding, you're going to get information that may not be as accurate as you'd like it to be to help you to make the decision as to which is your better choice. And one of the problems that happens is with renewal information on a fully insured plan, many times, this is the game, you're supposed to get the information somewhere around 90 days before the renewal date. So if you've got, especially if you're somebody who's trying to judge whether or not you should go stay fully insured or go self-funded, very often that information is supposed to come to you 90 days before so you can have some time to look at where you are and then make an educated decision on whether or not you should change from fully insured to self-funding. You're gonna find that that information now, and for years it's been the game, but now really doesn't come to you till much later. When you look for detailed information, a lot of times they're hiding behind the privacy acts, so that not so much is revealed about the risk. And by the time you've worked your way through getting the information from your carrier that you wanted, your renewal date passes. Okay, so I'm not saying it happens with everybody, it happens with a lot of carriers, and especially now as more and more the groups are moving towards self-funding, the fully insured groups, companies are really getting scared because that's their real profit margin. Those are their money makers, and they're trying to protect them. Okay, so with renewal information, it's delayed until after competing carriers have a reasonable time to submit a bid. Another problem that you have is carving out the prescription drug benefit. When I first met Jackie, one of the first things she said to me was, you know, is our prescription drug plan carved out? Because in a lot of cases, what you're gonna see is with a fully insured plan, they wanna sell you everything that's also fully insured. So they package them together, you believe you have some kind of a discount, and when you can actually pull these things apart, in many cases, I won't tell you in every case, but in many cases, you are much better off in a self-funded scenario, okay? So now you're going to get a look at a scary number here. Fully insured plans are governed by the states, okay? But you can see health insurers face 2,200 state-mandated benefits across the U.S. So it's not in one state. You know, we're saying in all the states, they've got a cumulative group of laws, 2,200, that health insurers that are mandated by, okay? In a fully, pardon me, a self-funded plan, you're not governed by state law, you're governed by federal law, ERISA. So ERISA is the Employee Retirement Income Security Act. But it exempts self-funded plans from the state laws. So here's the real beauty of this thing. This is how we are able to circumvent a lot of the state taxes. So actually all of the state taxes. So 2 to 3%, depending on what state you're going to, is going to be the actual state tax. But now the additional taxes I'm going to talk about a little bit later that really make this a tremendous difference come from the Affordable Care Act that's happened. But anyway, long story short, because of ERISA, self-funded plans have greater flexibility in terms of designing and greater cost savings options. Again, because of your ability to design and change your program, you're not governed by the state law. You're not paying the state tax, but you're also not governed by the state mandates, right? So you've got a lot more freedom and flexibility, okay? But also with that comes the freedom to change vendors, because in a fully insured structure, you're typically tied to one carrier, and that carrier is going to try to sell you everything they have. They're always going to sell you, if you've got the medical, they're always going to sell you the prescription drug. But they may also sell you dental, and they may have you for vision. And this is where you can really lose some money. So within the self-funded structure, we're free to change the medical carrier, the prescription drug carrier, the dental carrier, vision, stop-loss carriers, and we don't have to go back. We're not changing any plan design. We're just changing carriers. We take the same plan design to whoever's giving us the best deal, okay? And that's critically important, especially right now. Especially right now in the current environment, because anybody who's still in the fully insured business is looking to save as much of that business as they can. So here we go. In a fully insured plan, they use historical claims data. So there are some real gains that come with this. If you have a very sick group, a fully insured plan is probably where you're going to be and where you're going to stay. And typically that would be older people like me who aren't in such good health. That group's going to look a lot like me. But if your group has a nice spread in terms of age and good health like your group, you can do a whole lot better. But long story short, fully insured plans use historical claims experience. And with the Affordable Care Act, what looks like it would have created a real problem for them, they're actually using to their advantage now. But anyway, historical claims they use to predict future claims, okay, and to develop their premiums. Two things have happened. With the Affordable Care Act, groups under 100 lives now are allowed to continue community rating. Community rating is only good for the groups that have a lot of people like me. Okay? Community rating is not good for a young group or a group that spreads their age well. But beyond that, one of the problems that you have in a fully insured plan is that your stop loss level is where you want it to be. Your individual, for each individual person, as they incur claims, you get to name that level, you get to identify that level that you want to stop incurring your claim and to have an insurer take over for it. With a fully insured plan, you don't get that. They're going to tell you what their pooling level is, and they're typically very high. They're using that now because they're being controlled, the fully insured plans are being controlled by the Affordable Care Act. in terms of their profits. So if they've got a group that's considered a large group, they have a total of 15% that they can charge over their claims that, you know, that they can get their profit, their administrative fees and all those other wonderful things. But if it's a for-profit carrier, profit's going to be the most important thing. If it's a not-for-profit, it's contribution to surplus, but that's still a very important number. So what we've got now is with these high pooling levels, these claims that they were always paying anyway are showing higher for them. It looks like they're actually losing more money. They're not. The game didn't really change. It's just that they're able to write it off and pass it off better. So even though the Affordable Care Act thinks they've done a job on these guys, they can still work the deal. So fully insured rates are going to continue to rise. They're not going to be held, they're not going to be controlled the way the Affordable Care Act was hoping they would do. So anyway, long story short, fully insured plan takes a look at the experience, predicts what the premium would be. If the premium that they need is higher than what they needed for the year, they keep it, okay? Which makes sense. Because by the way, if they didn't get it right and their premium was lower, they lose the money, but they'll get you on the renewal. Okay. So here we go with self-funding. Let's take a look at the self-funding basics. Claims experience is that you're paying your claims as they come in. So what we're gonna look with you is we take a look at your claims experience for the year, we take a look back at the prior years, give a little bit of leverage to that, knowing what the inflation rates are for medical and for prescription drug. We're gonna put those numbers to it, and then we're gonna project what the claims should be for the next year with a little bit of a margin in there, okay? If we get it wrong, there's a fail-safe in here that's a very important fail-safe. It's the stop-loss premium. Because we don't know who's gonna get sick every year. We have no idea. Some people, you can kind of predict from the risk. We don't know individually who they are, but you can kind of predict from the risk as we get the information from the insurance company. But long story short, we have to go, we take the past experience plus the future experience and we work with it. But here's the big difference here is, if the claims are greater than we thought on a particular individual, you're gonna get reimbursed for those claims that are over that designated stop loss point. Anyway, so that's one way that we stabilize the claims experience. The reduced expenses in a fully insured plan in terms of reducing expenses, premium paid to the carrier covers a variety of their expenses, but it covers basically the insurance charge, the administrative charge, and the profit margin, okay? Self-insured plan has the ability to control all their expenses on an unbundled basis, but there's no profit margin, okay? So that's another big number that comes into here. For-profit insurers are expected to provide a competitive return for their shareholders. Not-for-profits make a contribution to surplus. And you'll hear that a lot, we're a not-for-profit. Do you have a contribution to surplus? And yes, you do, or you wouldn't be running. You wouldn't be in business. Self-funded plans, no need to pay profit for their plan to an insurer or administrator. Administrative costs are much lower. If you don't like the way the administrator runs it, or you think they're charging you too much, which we go out to market to look at all these things, we can just move to another administrator. We don't change the plan design, unless we have to, unless it's been negotiated. We don't change anything other than just moving from one administrator to another, or one stop-loss insurer to another. Okay, we talked about the premium taxes, but this stuff is getting to be pretty heavy duty. Premium taxes vary from state to state, but tax savings for a self-funded plan are 2-3% in a state. Avoiding the state, federal, and Affordable Care Act, that's the ACA taxes, is going to be greater than 6% for this group in Pennsylvania. For some groups, depending on the state, it could be a lot higher than that. Okay, so we have cash flow advantages for self-funding. Fully insured plans are level monthly premiums. I mean, they're just level premiums. They are what they are. The cash flow part is if we have fixed administrative fees that we know we have, reinsurance and retention premiums are paid monthly. So when we look at the beginning of the year, we know what our fixed costs are. Right now, our only variable are the claims that are paid as they're presented. And by the way, we're in a bad interest environment right now, but if interest rates rise at all, then you're going to see some additional advantages, which are the advantages that come with the cash flow. When, as you're paying the claims, you have about a 2 to 3 month, depending on the claim itself, advantage, yeah, month to like a cash flow advantage. So anyway, so there we are. I have, when we look at the vendors themselves, the self-funded plans, unbundled, we're free to contract with everybody, the best services, administration, and pricing advantages. It's up to us to find them, and we're out there each year looking for them. The one thing that I did want to mention to you right now is that, I guess it was this past January, Jackie and I were talking, Jackie McHale, and I were talking about what we were going to do for Blue Cross this year to try to get our, the best deal that we could, because we knew we were up for renewal for the administrative and the prescription drug fees. And Jackie mentioned to me that Bucksmont had made the decision to move to Aetna. And Jackie's blessing and advice, we went to Blue Cross, and we have, we're not done yet, but we've got ourselves a really nice renewal administratively. And I want to thank Jackie for the guidance on this one, because this was huge. She backed us up. We went to Blue Cross and said, listen, given the scenario with Bucksmont schools moving to Aetna, we know you're in a position where you don't want to lose a big school district like Pennridge. And they were very agreeable. And then they said, here's what we've been thinking, because what we said was, we need to get better administrative fees. We know we can go to Aetna without joining Bucksmont, and we get some great rates, because 2 years ago we looked at Aetna and we knew we had a much better administrative fee. Bottom line is, they said to us, we're looking at some things right now, but there's a group that's being put together, and it's referred to as the Independent Public Schools Group. That a few schools in Bucks County and maybe some in Montgomery County would be joining. But what we got just last week from Blue Cross is that it looks like it's going to save you about eight or so, because it depends on our stop-loss carrier. Depending on who we choose with our stop-loss carrier, we could get a little bit more of a bump on this administrative fee. But we've got to get, we've got to measure everything out and see what our best deal is. Long story short, between the administrative fee savings and the stop loss savings that we'll come away with, because we already know we're in really good shape with both of them, it's going to be significant. And I would say between the two of them, we're looking at, I'm comfortable saying $90,000 to $100,000 in savings for this year. So, but this lady set the ball in motion there. I think everybody needs to know that. So there we are. So let me just move us down a little bit. And I'm going to show you what we look like for this year, and we've got a 5-year look back for you. Okay. So I'm going to have to look up here because my glasses won't help me here. So here's what we have. If you look across the top, you're seeing plan year 2011-12, 2012-13, 2013-14, 14-15, 15-16, and then projected, that last one, that's a projected column for next year, okay? So what we've done is, as you did a great job putting together some nice contracts for us. So there are some plan design changes that are figuring into our projection for next year. But in addition to that, we've got the savings that we haven't taken all of the savings on the administrative fee. We took of $80,000, we took about, projected at 80 or so, we took about $50,000 in the administrative fee. So that savings is still out there. We didn't do anything I'll move down this thing for a second, but I just mentioned how we didn't do anything. We have some stop loss savings that we're going to realize. We haven't taken any of that in there, okay? So anyway, so here's what we do. We go across the top. So that first number you're going to see is total medical. Those numbers, as you see them going across the top, 7,491 across the 9,445. That is medical and administrative fees, okay? The next one down is prescription drug, total prescription drug. The next one down is the total number of prescriptions. So scripts, you know, we're writing abbreviated things to try to fit all this thing, all of this in. The next thing down you'll see is cost per script. And I'll give you an example of what's happened with that, because a specialty drug is killing everybody, not just your school district, everybody. We all know that. Peter, we've talked about that for years. Years ago, we got upset when it hit the average cost hit like $50 a script. And I want to tell you something. Now, you know, as we look, it went as high as $119.33 in 2014-15. And that really started to scare us. It's gone back down again. And a lot of this is, you know, do you have somebody who's really ill and using these drugs? And if it's any of us, we want the drug. But the problem could be if you have too many, you know, if you have more than a few, even in a given plan year, it can really can happen. Okay, and there's nothing we can do about it. Just, you know, hope for the best. But anyway, long story short, we've got some other things coming. There's one other savings, and we haven't gotten this yet. But if it's coming in the renewal, it's going to be for the prescription drug. So we'll be putting hopefully some more money in, you know, in savings on that one. So let me just work my way down here a little bit further and say, I just want to take you down. Number of covered employees, you can see that it's dropped over the years, 837 back in 2011-12. 784 is what we're projecting for, you know, this coming year, because that's what it was this year. The next line is disappearing for us for the most part. PPACA fees, the Affordable Care Act is actually the PPACA, but we're, for the sake of brevity, we're going to call it the ACA, right? But anyway, that's diminishing for us. We've got one more year that we're paying on what's called the reinsurance fee, which is to pay for large claims that the fully insured plans are paying in the exchanges. So they're taking on X number of people who are very, very sick, and they're understandably losing money. So these reinsurance fees are being paid by every group plan in the country to help fund that. Now the bad news is that the insurance companies, the reasons you're seeing that the insurance companies are trying to get out of the exchanges now, they're thinking about it, is that they've only, a lot of them collected like 13% of the money that they were going to get. So they're losing money like crazy. But anyway, long story short, I digress, but I just had to say that. Those fees, we're going to be down to one fee, which is a research fee, that they're supposed to be each year, you know, researching ways to make life better for all of us. So that research fee is going to continue to rise, but that's you know, just a couple thousand dollars a year. That's not going to kill you. The reinsurance fee started out at, you know, $80,000. It was actually even the first year that they had it. We had it in the medical, the total medical was $126,000 or something like that. So anyway, that's going away. The gross plan cost, you can see, $10,163,000, and you'll go across each year. This year we're thinking it's going to be $12,412,000. Then what we do is, for the projection, the next line down you're going to see is what we think the stop loss reimbursement will be. You can look across those years and see that it's always been pretty healthy. I'm just saying $200,000 because I believe, looking at where we are, that's probably a pretty good number. It may be better than, you know, maybe more than that. But adjusted plan cost, then you can see where we are. And if we go up a little bit more. Okay, if we go up a little bit more, I'm going to take you down to the increase or decrease over the prior years. Okay, so you'll see from 2010 to 2011, it went up 17.3%. In 2011 and 2012, okay? Then it went up 20%, so we were in a straight up rocket and we were scared. But then all of a sudden, this is self-funding. You just don't know what's gonna happen with self-funding. we know that we've got a strong enough base that we had a pretty good understanding of where the costs were, but every so often you'll get a skyrocket or two. You get a couple of really bad claims, and you hope for the best. But anyway, you can see where it is. So 0.2, then 6.7, negative 0.7, 1.68. So these are really good numbers, and what I want to say to you is that this projection for 2016-17, in my mind right now, is conservative, because we haven't nailed down everything to where we want it to be, but I feel good about this year. I think that we're going to have a very good year, but a lot of the stuff is you're hoping for it. I'm going to take it down real quick to this one. This goes 2008 to 2017, and I'm going to take it down to the bottom so I don't bore you to death. So we went from negative 1.23% in 2008-2009, and you can see where it was. We had some wonderful years. We got to the point where we thought, this is great, nothing ever goes wrong. And then we had the 17 and the 20, we realized, it was just roll of the dice. But there we are. If we look back, I can go back ad infinitum for you, but you get a really good strong feel for the history of this plan design. I would tell you most groups would kill to get a steady 6%. We've had a lot of ones and zeros and things like that in there too, so you need to see that. But again, it goes up and down, and we can't control it. We can control our fixed costs, we can't control the claims. That's pretty much it. Does anybody have any questions or concerns? I'll just tell you this then. Does anybody have a question?
Any board members? Mr. Allen?
I'll just tell you real quick. So our 2015 plan costs are based on claims through March 31, and then they're annualized, okay? 2016 plan costs used includes this independent schools, independent suburban schools. And what we need to clarify, I guess I better say this, Jackie, our understanding from talking with the Blue Cross folks is that if there's a three-year rate set up on it, just like they do for everybody on an administrative phase, three-year rate set up, our understanding is you're not tied into that group if you decided to move, to do something else, to go with another carrier or whatever. But we still need to confirm that one, because we had it verbally, we saw some things, and we need to get it in writing for you.
There you go. You read my mind. I want it in writing.
Okay, you got it, Steve. So we've got it. Anyway, last thing I'll say to you is PPACA fees, 2014-15-16 are included in totals. So, you've got all the stuff in there that you need to look at the cost of these plans.
Thanks, Mr.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Okay, so comments from the audience. Yes, ma'am.
He's talking about the cost of the
plane. Would you mind going to the microphone?
No, I don't mind at all.
Your name and your municipality, please.
Sure.
Thank you.
Sue Furlong, West Rock Hill Township, and I was watching this very astutely. It's, it appears that we're controlling costs, but the costs are going up despite over 50 reduced number of participants. So I think that if you really want a thorough understanding of what is happening to your costs, yeah, it's great to look at the great big numbers and, the whole total plan went up 1.2%, but you need to look at it on a per person cost, because I know that you haven't replaced some of the teachers and maybe some of the other staff members. I don't know exactly what your situation is, but per his head count as to who is covered, you have lost something like 53 or 4 participants. So you need to understand on a per person basis what is happening to your cost, because that is what's driving the cost.
It is on a per person.
It's there.
It's there.
Next to the last line. Oh, was that the per person?
Yeah. That's what it is.
Where is that?
It's
next to last line, the first line.
Yeah, next to last line.
Average cost per.
Okay, I missed that. Here again, your total cost, I'm looking at that 1.62%. I don't have my glasses on, honestly. I can't see that top number clearly. But, you know, that's where you have to control your cost. My advice is don't hire any smokers.
I'd also just like to add that we just completed an annual review with Blue Cross where they do go into much more detail, minute detail in regard to especially our catastrophic or high-end claims. That's about a three-hour meeting that we wouldn't want to bore the board with. But Mr. Dodbert, myself, and Mr. Allen did spend a good better part of 3 hours digging through the claims with our representatives from Blue Cross. So we do give that due diligence. Just as a side note, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your comment, though. Anyone else? Adjourned.